This episode is supported by the Great Courses Plus.
Outer space, used and shared peacefully, offers incredible benefits to humanity in communication, science, and soon resource gathering and even settlement. But there are some who eye the heavens with distinctly unpeaceful, even warlike motives. The decades directly following World War II were a time of optimism in many ways. Industrialization was finally improving the quality of life for a lot of us. Science was making incredible bounds, and our sights were set on the stars. It seemed to many that we were on a trajectory to a spacefaring technological utopia. The United Federation of Planets was just around the corner. But the possibility of a much darker space age also loomed, one in which the space around the Earth became highly militarized and, in fact, massively weaponized. In 1957, the Soviet Union launched Sputnik One, the world's first artificial satellite. They also tested the first intercontinental ballistic missile, ICBM. The space race had begun, and it inspired some incredible advances in science and exploration, culminating in the moon landing in 69. It also inspired a race to win the military advantage of low Earth orbit. By the early 60s, the United States and the USSR were regularly launching satellites of all types and rapidly accumulating increasingly advanced ICBMs. Those ICBMs were the first space weaponry. While they don't actually enter orbit, they exceed the altitudes of most low Earth orbit satellites, hitting around 1,200 kilometers at the peak of their trajectories. Despite definitely being in space, these are called suborbital trajectories because they don't actually reach orbital velocity. Ballistic means that most of the journey is unpowered. ICBMs follow the parabolic path dictated by gravity when they're between an initial boost phase and an optional final guided phase. ICBM technology quickly developed to the point that a single missile could deliver multiple nuclear warheads several thousand kilometers away in a half hour. One Soviet program, the Fractional Orbital Bombardment System, actually did enter true orbit, and it would allow multiple warheads to be delivered anywhere in the world from any direction. As the arms race proceeded, both superpowers also turned to space to defend against this rising existential threat. Reconnaissance satellites, SpySats in particular, provided a level of intelligence gathering previously impossible across the Iron Curtain. This was really the only effective way to monitor the rapid proliferation of launch facilities. Now, those early SpySats came long before digital cameras, and so film canisters were ejected by the satellites and retrieved either on the surface or in mid-parachute descent. The Soviets did build one spy satellite that contained actual spies. These were the Almaz space stations. Crews of 2 to 3 cosmonauts / peeping toms could develop film on board for rapid response to anything they spotted. Only two of these were ever actually crewed for brief periods between 74 and 77. The first Almaz station, Salyut 3, was also the very first weaponized satellite. It was equipped with a 23mm autocannon designed to defend against enemy anti-satellite measures. It was only ever fired once as a test. But if we're talking about satellite weapons platforms, we should talk about Star Wars. And by that, I mean the Strategic Defense Initiative, announced by Ronald Reagan in 1983. It was an attempt to break the stalemate of the arms race and transcend the dubious security of mutually assured destruction by vastly increasing the United States' missile defense capabilities. It included much expanded surface launch anti-ballistic missile, ABM, networks, but also, and get this, an atomic bomb-powered X-ray laser satellite. This was the Excalibur program, and it very nearly saw the launch of what could only be described as a space-based superweapon. A quick review on lasers. They work by exciting electrons in a substance to high energy states. Then, by passing electromagnetic radiation at a wavelength tuned to an energy level transition in that substance, stimulated emission can occur. The excited electron releases its energy as a photon that exactly matches the phase and direction of the seed photon. This produces a beam of coherent light, making it possible to deliver very large intensities in very narrow beams. X-ray lasers were seen as extremely promising in missile defense because they can completely vaporize metal. X-rays are quickly absorbed in the atmosphere, but in the vacuum of space, these lasers can have ranges of many hundreds, even thousands of kilometers. Now, normal lasers bounce the beam back and forth through a gain medium to build up power, but X-rays can't be reflected easily, so a powerful X-ray laser needs to start with a powerful X-ray source. For Excalibur, that source was a nuclear bomb, set off behind an array of laser tubes. The satellite doesn't survive the blast, but that's okay. One blast is enough to power several dozen X-ray lasers, and each of those can take out an ICBM. The dream of Excalibur was that a small number of platforms could take out the entire Soviet missile fleet, even if it were launched simultaneously. The media derisively nicknamed the Strategic Defense Initiative Star Wars. It absorbed many hundreds of millions in funding from 1983 to 1990, but ultimately it was defunded for two reasons. One, it was never clear whether any of the 10 underground test detonations produced anything near the promised laser amplification. And two, no one could come up with a decent plan to protect the satellites. These things would need to live in more near orbits, highly elliptical orbits that allowed them to spend most of their time above a particular location on the surface, i.e. Russia. But that left them extremely susceptible to attack by missiles. Another slight issue with the Excalibur program was that it would pretty thoroughly violate the Outer Space Treaty. This treaty, ratified by the US in 1967, prohibits signatories from placing nukes or other weapons of mass destruction in orbit or on a celestial body. The treaty is now ratified by 107 nations and seriously limits the potential for nuclear space war. ICBMs are still allowed because they don't actually enter orbit, but the nuke-powered Excalibur was a definite no-no. The Outer Space Treaty does have its loopholes. So-called conventional weapons are allowed in space, so non-nuke-powered lasers and also the potentially very deadly kinetic impact weapons. The successor to Excalibur, Brilliant Pebbles, was just such a weapon. A kinetic weapon does all of its damage by hitting things with fast-moving, non-explosive chunks of matter. Brilliant Pebbles proposed an orbiting weapons platform that delivered non-explosive missiles to destroy ICBMs. Besides not violating the Outer Space Treaty, this plan beat Excalibur because you didn't need to destroy the weapons platform to use it. That meant a few pebbles could be launched to protect against an incoming anti-satellite missile while leaving the platform functional. But even this proposal proved too expensive, and it was cancelled in the early 90s. Another example of a kinetic impact proposal was Project Thor. It was never a funded project, as far as we know, but the idea was to drop 9-ton, 6-meter-long tungsten cylinders from orbit. They would strike the ground at Mach 10 with a destructive equivalent of more than 11 tons of TNT, similar to the lowest yield tactical nukes. These rods from God had a pretty niche application. Very sudden precision strikes with no surface launch signature to serve as warning, and they wouldn't violate the Outer Space Treaty. By the way, both Excalibur and Brilliant Pebbles were considered as anti-satellite weapons, ASATs, as well as being anti-ICBM measures. But research into destroying satellites began much earlier. In the 2 years following the launch of Sputnik, the US was already testing anti-satellite missiles launched from a B-47 bomber. However, the first successful ASAT missile was in 1985, when a US F-15 fighter launched a specialized missile that destroyed SolWind, a retired solar observatory satellite. The USSR pursued some very different ASAT paths. Their Istrebitel Sputnik, literally satellite fighter, was a missile designed to actually enter orbit and maneuver up close to its target satellite before exploding. By the early 70s, these things were successfully damaging test satellites. The program was even upgraded in the late 70s to be effective against the upcoming US space shuttle. True to their Western stereotypes as Bond supervillains, the USSR also played around with powerful ground-based lasers, which supposedly blinded some US spy satellites, and particle beams, actual death rays, which never really worked. Then there was the Polyus spacecraft, a full-fledged orbiting battle station that would have had a megawatt laser designed to take out the as-yet-unlaunched US anti-missile satellites. Polyus never became operational, though it was very close. Over the decades, multiple nations have worked on adapting suborbital ballistic missiles to target satellites. However, very few satellites have ever been destroyed in this way. In 2007, China destroyed one of its own weather satellites with a missile, and this was scary in two ways. One, the resulting debris massively increased the amount of space junk in low Earth orbit. Something like 1/6 of currently tracked debris is from this one event. And two, it also sparked a new race to develop ASAT capability. The US quickly followed in 2008 by destroying one of its own spy sats with a repurposed ship-based anti-ballistic missile. The official line is that the satellite was decaying from orbit, and the purpose of its destruction was to avoid the unlikely event of its fuel tank of toxic hydrazine from reaching the ground. Whether or not this was the true main motive, at the very least the debris wasn't as dangerous as the Chinese explosion, because that debris's orbit will decay much more quickly. Currently, the US, Russia, China, Israel, and India have either functioning or developmental ASAT missile capabilities. There's a potential new arms race threatening. That's concerning. Even a few destroyed satellites could begin a chain reaction as the resulting debris hits and destroys more satellites in an increasingly crowded low Earth orbit. There's a serious risk of wreathing the Earth in a growing shell of mangled silicon and metal. As real as that risk is, we once risked much worse. The Cold War arms race was on track to fill Earth's orbit with satellite-destroying weaponry and nuclear warheads. For the most part, and for the moment, saner heads have prevailed, and humanity remains committed to the peaceful use of outer space-time.
Thanks to The Great Courses Plus for sponsoring this episode. The Great Courses Plus is a digital learning service that allows you to learn about a range of topics from Ivy League professors and other educators from around the world. Go to thegreatcoursesplus.com/spacetime and get access to a library of different video lectures about science, math, history, literature, or even how to cook, play chess, or become a photographer. New subjects, lectures, and professors are added every month. The course, Understanding the Inventions That Changed the World by Professor Bernard Carlson, is a real journey through the history of human ingenuity. It covers nuclear energy and weaponry as well as satellites, but I think I had the most fun with the episode on the invention of the crossbow. They were, of course, one of the early kinetic bombardment weapons. With The Great Courses Plus, you can watch as many different lectures as you want, anytime, anywhere, without tests or exams. Help support the series and start your free one-month trial by clicking on the link below or going to thegreatcoursesplus.com/spacetime. As always, thanks so much to all of our Patreon supporters. Spacetime remains a passion project for all of us, but you help make it a financially viable passion project. And today, I want to give a special huge thanks to Big Bang contributor Joshua Davis. Joshua, we saved up your contribution to buy one of those 6-foot-tall tungsten rods from God for the studio. We have no idea what we're going to do with it, but it seemed like something we should have, and we named it Josh in your honor. And speaking of weaponized space, for anyone who doesn't want to get their eyes burned out by accidentally looking at the August 21st total solar eclipse, we made some Spacetime eclipse glasses. We're shipping them to all Patreon contributors at the $5 level and above, or to anyone who joins up at or increases to that level in the month of July, at least until we run out of glasses. Okay, let's get to your comments from last week, when we talked about tricks for solving the impossible equations of quantum field theory. RosieisaBoss noticed that the theoretical electron mass going to infinity sounds a lot like the ultraviolet catastrophe of the pre-Max Planck description of black body radiation. Well, very, very well spotted. In fact, the analogy is so relevant that physicists call the infinities resulting from high energy loops ultraviolet divergences in reference to the ultraviolet catastrophe. Nicholas Aiello asks if it's possible that electrons have no fundamental mass and are made up entirely of self-energy. Well, in a sense, that's actually the case. The so-called bare mass of an electron comes from its interaction with the Higgs field. It's not the same as the self-energy interaction, but it's analogous in some ways. The Higgs field exchanges weak hypercharge with the electron via W bosons, causing its chirality to flip. We talk about this in our Higgs mechanism episode. It's a very different interaction to the self-energy interaction, but the result is the same. Electron mass comes from its interaction with other fields, be it the Higgs field for the bare mass or the electromagnetic field for the self-energy correction to that mass. Zach Crawford asks, how do we know that two electrons scatter off each other rather than just pass through each other, given that both electrons are identical? Well, thanks for asking. In fact, we have no idea which outgoing electron corresponds to which incoming electron. All we know is the momenta of all of those electrons. When we draw the Feynman diagrams for electron scattering, we need to include separate diagrams in which the ingoing electrons swap places. A few of you asked why it is that each additional vertex reduces the probability contribution of a given Feynman diagram by around a factor of 100. And actually, a few of you answered this in the comments also, but let me take a shot. Every one of those vertices represents an interaction between the electron and the electromagnetic fields. The probability of that interaction is governed by the coupling constant between those fields, so the electric charge, which in turn depends on the fine structure constant. In fact, the probability amplitude added at each vertex is proportional to the square root of the fine structure constant. Probability itself is the square of the probability amplitude, so that's the square root of 1 over 137 squared, which is just the fine structure constant, which is close to 1%. For every additional interaction between the EM and the electron field, so every additional vertex, another one of these 1% probability events has to occur. Only Name Left Here thinks our videos are good and stuff, but will unsubscribe if we set the fine structure constant to 1 over 100 once more. Wow, OCD much? I think we have a particle physicist in the house. You guys think you're so cool measuring the fine structure constant to better than one part in a billion? I feel like I'm doing precision astrophysics if I set pi to 3 instead of 1.